We're on a mission from God.
And now for something completely different.
This is Pastor Jolly John Lekumsky, and I have with me
Pastor Matt Youngblood Clark from Ascension Lutheran Church in beautiful South St. Louis.
Yeah, and I'm nowhere. I'm just a retired guy, so it doesn't matter where I'm at.
You are being a blessing to the church, preaching and filling in, though, John, so we thank you for it.
Yeah,
thanks
but
for serving your retirement.
I'm like a wandering Aramean because you never know where I'm going to turn up.
So where are you right now? Where are you recording from?
I'm in New Athens right now. But
okay.
Next week we'll be up in Minnesota, and then we'll be back here to New Athens. And I'm actually going to be I'll be at Conant in Pinckneyville this Sunday if anyone wants to come in.
Okay, good deal.
Before we go any further, though, I have something I want to share. We have been sharing with these highly curated puns from my wife, Lynn's daily pun calendar. But
I've got some here.
Well, we just got one, and this is outstanding. This, in fact, all the others will pale in comparison to this pun.
Oh boy, here we go.
Well, for number one, because it actually educates you, and I love jokes that give us knowledge. But here's the other reason I like it, because it's a pun you have to think about. Don't you like it when the jokes
have to think? It's a thinker.
It's a thinker. Okay.
All right, John. Lay it on us.
So here's the knowledge part. Do you know the difference between an alligator? This isn't a joke, by the way. I'm just asking you. Do you know the difference between an alligator and a crocodile?
I think their mouth is shaped differently for one, right?
Well, okay. So you've crystallized it. I think we all know there are differences like that. But
sure.
Can you ever remember which one's the alligator and which one's the crocodile?
See? I thought the alligator had the skinnier nose, but I'm not sure. If I saw one in the wild, John, I'd probably just run the other way regardless. So I probably would not have the time to identify which one it is.
We just want to get away from them.
That's right.
Well, so this will solve that problem because I can never remember for sure which was which either. And by the way, we are the number one Saturday morning Bible study amongst herpetologists. Did you know that?
That is.
The latest, more herpetologists listen to us than any other Saturday morning Bible
That's
study.
That's impressive. You know, KFUO should publicize that more, John. I don't see them publicizing that.
No,
come on.
I don't know why.
This is a golden opportunity.
So here, for all of our herpetologist listeners, here's the pun. You can distinguish an alligator from a crocodile by paying attention to whether the animal sees you later.
Sees you what, John?
Sees you later.
Well, or after
Did
a while.
You get it? Well,
yeah,
of course, that would make the difference.
Yes, yeah. Is he going to see later or after a while?
You can distinguish an alligator from a crocodile by paying attention to whether the animal sees you later. Alligator.
Yes, I got
All right.
Thank you, Jeff.
It wasn't as good
I love
as
it. No, that's a keeper. That is a keeper. No, I enjoyed that one. Well done.
Frame it and put it on the walls. And
the buildup was worth it. By the way, my wife got a message from a listener to Wrestling the Basics thanking us
cool.
for the puns. They said they've enjoyed them. However, they didn't talk about the rest of the shows. The puns were at least good. The rest of the show kind of downhill from there, I guess. But hey, we've got good puns. So.
Well, maybe we'll have to start mixing them up throughout the show so people will have to listen.
There you go.
So you're suggesting people listen for the first 5 minutes. Oh, that's it. The puns are over.
You never know. Yeah, we'll just pepper them throughout the show. You never know when you're going to hear a pun.
That's right. When the
reason
next
enough
pun
to
will
listen.
Be. So we actually, we don't need puns because we have some really outstanding biblical material. It's not because of us, but because of the word of Jesus. because there's these two great images that Jesus gives us that we always talk about after Easter. The one, of course, is Good Shepherd Sunday. Jesus is the Good Shepherd. And then the other one we have this year, which is cool, is Jesus is the vine and we are the branches. So that's what we're going to be giving to our listeners today and next week. And Matt, would you like to start then with the whole image of Jesus as the Good Shepherd?
Yeah, I'd be happy to, John. Boy, John is just packed full of images like that, which I really love. It gives us glimpses of who Jesus is, who our Savior is, these tangible things that helps us to better understand what kind of Savior Jesus is. So we've got, you know, the vine, the branches, the shepherd, and sheep. You've got, I'm the resurrection, I'm the door, and it goes on and on. So to pick up on a couple of these pictures, I think is really great. I'm looking forward to it. So the first one is the shepherd. I am the good shepherd. So we're in John chapter 10. And why don't we go ahead and just read the text first, John, and then we'll unpack it together. But John chapter 10, begin with verse 7. So why don't we do verses 7 through 14.
Now you're confusing me because he says he's the door, but whatever.
Yeah, well, we can talk about that too.
Okay. We've got, all right.
So about 7 through, how about 7 through 15?
Okay. So Jesus again said to them, "Truly, truly, I say to you, amen, amen," actually in the Greek, "I am the door of the sheep. All who came before me are thieves and robbers, but the sheep did not listen to them. I am the door. If anyone enters by me, he will be saved and will go in and out and find pasture. The thief comes only to steal and kill and destroy. I came that they may have life and have it abundantly. I am the good shepherd. The good shepherd lays down his life for the sheep. He who is a hired hand and not a shepherd, who does not own the sheep, sees the wolf coming and leaves the sheep and flees, and the wolf snatches them and scatters them. He flees because he's a hired man and cares nothing for the sheep. I am the good shepherd. I know my own, and my own know me. Just as the Father knows me, and I know the Father, and I lay down my life for the sheep." There
All right.
we go.
Thanks, John. Yeah, thanks very much. We're going to focus on the shepherd part, but I mean, just since you brought up, you know, Jesus also says, "I am the door," and then he's talking about this door to this sheep pen. So we're kind of working with this whole picture of sheep and shepherds and doors and pens, and all of it kind of works together. But then, yeah, in verse 9, it says, "I'm the door. If anyone enters by me, he'll be saved and will go in and out and find pasture." So, you know, I think that picture of the door, kind of anyone too, that he is the gate, the door, we could say the way even to eternal life. He will be saved and go in and out and find pasture. So I think that, you know, just to briefly touch on that, I think it relates a little bit to those words we'll see later in John's gospel where he says, he is the way, right? The way.
Yeah.
So he is the door, the way to eternal life. So we've got the door and certainly a beautiful image there too, but I wanted to focus on the shepherd. And Jesus makes this distinction, right, between the shepherd and the hired hand. So they both are taking care of the sheep, right? The shepherd and the hired hand. But what is the distinction between the two? I think we see that there in verse 13, right? When there's trouble, the hired hand flees. And why does he flee when trouble arrives, when the wolf is on the prowl or the alligator or crocodile comes?
That's right. Thanks for segueing, keeping that in. That's good.
Yeah, there you go. Yeah. So verse 13, why does he flee?
Well, because he doesn't really care for the sheep. I think that would be the essence of the idea that he's a hired hand.
Yeah.
He's only in it for the money, what he can get out of it. So once his neck's on the line, he's skedaddle. He's doing exactly what you said at the beginning of the episode. He sees the terrible animal is, and he's just going to run.
Yeah. See you later, right?
Alligator. Okay.
Alligator. So he runs. And yeah, I completely agree. It's due to this lack of care, a lack of care. So then the very next verse talks about Jesus says he is not a hired hand. No, he's the good shepherd. And then what's one of the things that distinguishes him as the good shepherd there in verse 14?
Well, do you want both of the things? Because one is that he knows the sheep. All right. So he has this personal relationship with the sheep, which I think implies his care. But the thing that strikes me about this text, and we'd see this again if we read on, he lays down his life for the sheep. He's already said that twice, that he's going to lay down his life for the sheep. Yeah.
Yeah, exactly. So kind of, you know, because he knows the sheep and cares for the sheep, and then because of that, knowing them, caring for them, the result is, he'll even lay down his life. When that predator comes, he's not going to flee. Instead, he's willing to lay down his life for sheep, which is a profound truth. So what I wanted to pick up on is the importance of those two things, right? We talked about caring, and the hired hand cares nothing for a sheep. We talked about Jesus knowing the sheep, and along with that knowing, certainly caring too. So those two things, knowing and caring. Because I think, you know, one of the most hurtful things you could probably say is about someone or something is, I don't know and I don't care, right?
Yeah.
You know, so, you know, how's your sister doing? I haven't seen her in a while. I don't know and I don't care. Yeah, really. You know, I mean, that's rough. It's baseball season. Here's St. Louis. If you have someone, how's the Cardinals doing? And they answer, I don't know and I don't care. That's shocking.
Yeah.
What are you talking about? So I don't know and I don't care. And I think one of the truths is the more you know about someone, oftentimes the more you care about someone, right? So I think of, for example, you see someone, especially here in the city, John, you see someone at the busy intersection and they're disheveled and dirty and they're holding a sign, you know, please help, God bless, you know, and it's easy to just pass that person up, right? Just to pass them up without giving them much thought, just keep going through the intersection. But if you take time to get to know that person, if you knew that they were, for instance, a veteran, right, who's suffering from PTSD, post-traumatic stress disorder, and has, you know, tried all sorts of things, including substance abuse, to try to just sort of escape the pain that they feel, you know, and has been deserted by his wife and you know, and the, you know, just imagine that kind of story, right? Maybe a fear that he'll be unwelcomed in a church even, right? If you imagine that kind of story, getting to know that person on the side of the road, now all of a sudden, boy, it's a little easier to care for them. Maybe it's a little less easy to just drive by without showing a whole lot of compassion. So I think there's some truth to this. Knowing someone many times translates into caring for someone. And I think that's certainly the case here when we hear about Jesus as the good shepherd. He knows his own. His own know him, and he's willing to care so much, right, that he lays down his life for the sheep, which is a beautiful, beautiful thing. Go ahead.
Well, I just think it's interesting, Matt, that he must know something about us, that he knows he's going to have to lay down his life for us.
Yeah, that it's necessary even, right, for him to lay down his life for us. You know, as Jesus is speaking here, he's also, as you read a little before this, he's talking, some of the people he's talking to are like the Jewish Pharisees and chief priests. And so I can't help but think that he's kind of looking in their direction maybe a little bit when he's talking about the hired hand caring nothing for the sheep. You know, they should have been caring for God's flock. They should have been feeding them with God's word and defending them, right, against false teaching and against Satan himself. But when it comes to caring for God's flock, it just seems like the problem is deep down, they don't care. Instead, they're self-absorbed, self-serving. We see in the Gospels, even greed comes in and plays to that. And Jesus is different. Jesus is the shepherd, no hired hand. And I think we see that on Good Friday, the most clear, that Jesus isn't just giving this lip service, you know, lay down my life for the sheep, you know, type deal. No, he really does literally do just that. He lays down his life for us, for his sheep, there on the cross of Calvary. So I think just to know that our good shepherd both knows us and cares for us.
You know, you're talking about the Pharisees and the priests and everything. I think a classic example of that would be how they handled Judas. You know, Judas is sorrowful for what he's done. He comes back repentant. And what do they say? Literally, we don't know and we don't care.
Not our problem.
Is it of ours? Yeah, yeah.
Yeah, so, exactly. Yeah. Almost verbatim, really. Yep, I mean, that's essentially what they're saying. No, that's a great example. Exactly. You know, and what an opportunity for care and compassion for this guy. A couple other things I want to pick up. So I think another truth is, you know, the more we know, the more we care. I think that's generally true. But sometimes the more we know someone, the harder it is to care for them.
Hmm.
You know, think about that. So, you know, you think of, you know, the example of someone like a pro baseball player that a kid looks up to. So this is their hero, right? And they find out, though, that when they go to get his autograph, they just kind of get brushed off, don't have time for the kid. You know, it might be a little hard for that baseball fan to really care about that hero now that they know that they really, you know, don't care that much about him, right? They've known them a little better. So, or like the politician we voted for, right? And later we find out that they are not quite as honest as we thought they were. The more we know them, the harder it is for us to care for them, right? Or to care about them. I think there's some truth to that too. And I think then, you know, we start to think then maybe, well, what about me and my good shepherd, right? We are sheep of the shepherd. If Jesus really knew me, like really knew me, would he still care about me, right? I mean, if Jesus really knew my thoughts and my insecurities and my secret habits maybe that I keep from other people and my selfish ambitions, if he really knew me, would my good shepherd still care for me? And see, that's the thing. He does know us, right? And that can be kind of a scary thing sometimes. He does know us. Psalm 139 talks about how he knows our thoughts from afar, and he's familiar with our ways. And before words are even on our tongue, he knows what we're going to say. You know, he knows us better than anyone knows us. But the beautiful message of the gospel then is he still cares for us, even in spite of knowing all of our sins and faults and failures and all the ugliness and evil inside of us, right? He still cares for us.
Think of the context here, Matt, when he says, I know my sheep. So he knows that shortly, just within hours, these men are going to abandon him. One of them is going to deny him three times despite his protests. He would never do anything like that. And of course, the Judas who the priests and the will reject is the Judas who will, you know, betray Jesus. And yet Jesus, knowing all that, would still lay down his life for all of them.
And see, I think that's exactly it, John. If we wonder ever, if Jesus really knew me, and he does he still care for me? And if we ever question that, look to the cross, right? He is the good shepherd who laid down his life for the sheep. And that includes you. Whoever you are, listener, right now, it includes you. That even though Jesus knows us, he still came to this earth. He still suffered. He still didn't run away from danger when it popped up. He still laid down his life for the sheep. Still took it up again in his resurrection. And one day he's going to return for us sheep. And until that day, he promises to be with us always. If we need to know if Jesus still cares, we just look to his promises. We look to the cross. We look to all of his promises to know, even though he knows me and all my faults, he still cares for me. What a amazing a good shepherd that we have. What a comfort.
And it's interesting. That's why he has to lay down his life, because he does know us, and he knows we're sinners, and he knows we don't trust him, and we know we don't always love the neighbor the way we should. And of course, that's why he has to die in our place, take our punishment.
Exactly.
And he does it. He does it. That's what he's come to do.
Exactly. And he does it. He doesn't run away, you know, when the going gets tough. When Satan is on the prowl, you know, Jesus still continues to the cross and still continues to the open grave. So knowing someone can help us care more about someone. Knowing someone can also become a barrier to caring, maybe. But then I kind of want to, one other thing to touch on is, you know, that knowing about each other within the church, all right, within the flock of God's sheep, also, I think, leads us to caring for one another more, too. Okay, so the more we know each other, I think, within the church, hopefully, the more we care for one another. You know, we're sheep of the same flock. We are We have the same good shepherd after all. So I think, you know, one encouragement I have for our listeners is just to simply know your fellow Christians. And I hope and pray that you have a church home, a flock, a local flock that, that you are a part of and that you're a sheep of, and to get to know the other sheep. And as we know one another better, it's easier for us to care for one another. Because if we don't know each other, right, if we just come to church, we just kind of sit in the pew and don't really talk to anyone, and then we leave, it's kind of hard to care about the people sitting next to us, the people that we worship with. But if we really do know them, get to know them, boy, it's easier to care. So I think, you know, when we, there's some stuff we do around the church that sometimes people might think is, you know, kind of funny or maybe a waste of money or a waste of time, but there's deeper purposes to it, you know, and I'm just thinking of simple things like, you know, chatting before church or donuts, you know, in between services. That's about more than just donuts. You know, that's about knowing people and talking to each other. I think of things like we have trivia nights. That's about more than just raising money. That's about getting to know each other. And all of those opportunities to just know each other, to build community, to share life together, to truly know each other, because we need that. We need that. To take that metaphor a little further, I mean, if we're lone sheep out there, we're not going to last too long. The predator, the devil's going to gobble us up. But when we are together in a flock and guided by the good shepherd, there's safety, there's protection. There's joy, I hope, too, in that community as well. So, yeah. Any other thoughts on that, John?
Well, I think it actually comes straight out of the text. We've got the wolf who comes, and what he wants to do is he wants to scatter. He wants to scatter the sheep.
Yes, that's the goal.
So if he can't snatch them, at least he can scatter them. So you're right. The need to be gathering together as a community, that's very, very important. And that's I assume that the – do you think the wolf here – Is the devil? You think?
Oh yeah,
be fair.
Yeah, prowling around. Yeah, exactly.
Well, my own pastor, Pastor Bittner, pointed out that this is a word that's not used very often in the Bible. And what's unique about John's usage is it's in the singular, where it's used elsewhere in the Bible, it's usually the plural. You know, there's a bunch of wolves.
Oh, like a wolf pack, yeah.
Yeah, but this is just one wolf, mm-hmm. And it's also the only time that it has the article in front of it. It's not just a wolf, but it is the wolf. So I think, yeah, that's important for us to know. That's exactly that. No, the devil does not want you to have trivia night.
Yeah.
And he does not want you to eat donuts. Of course he doesn't, because donuts are the best thing you can eat. So you're right. That fellowship expressed both in worship and in communion, but also in all the other activities we do, particularly, I think, activities of service that we do together. That's all important for us as well. Yeah.
Yeah. So, I mean, if for no other reason than just ticking off the devil, come to church, come to the trivia night, you know, really, because that's where you're going to find protection. He's not going to scatter, right? Stay together as a flock. Under the care of the good shepherd. I think the other thing to bring up too is, you know, okay, fine. You know, we get to know each other. That's great. But guess what? As we get to know each other as fellow sheep and within God's house, I think we're also going to find out we're not always in agreement with each other. Imagine that,
okay.
John.
Yeah.
Maybe we didn't vote for the same candidate as the other sheep in the flock. Or maybe we didn't all go to that same high school. That's always big around here in St. Louis. What high school did you go to? Or a smaller town like New Athens, you know, maybe most people went to the same high school. Maybe the outsiders didn't, you know, or.
Hey, Matt, are some people like cake donuts and other people like glazed donuts? I mean, let's talk about the real crucial issues.
I know. We're divided.
So what are we going to have? What kind of donuts are we going to have? See, okay,
yes.
Go ahead.
Exactly. You know, these issues, though, that the more we know each other, oh my goodness. Well, there's some differences here, you know, but, you know, my encouragement is to our listeners and to me too, is to realize too, that as I guarantee, if we are sheep of the same flock, right, we have the same good shepherd, we have more in common with each other than we do different from each other. Guaranteed, right? because we have the truly important stuff in common. You know, with the stuff like knowing that, yeah, we are sheep of the same flock. We are lambs of our Savior's redeeming. And that, yeah, when we come to worship, we can say the words of the Apostles' Creed together, and we believe it. We believe the same thing about who God is. When we kneel at the communion rail, we believe, yeah, this really is Jesus' body and blood given and shed for me. And then we begin to rejoice with those who rejoice and weep with those who weep. So, you know, if as you get to know other members of the flock, other people within the church, yeah, maybe there are some differences, but the important stuff, the stuff of faith, right? The stuff we confess together, we do have in common. And boy, that's a greater bond than anything else this side of heaven. And I think that knowing each other in that way, Lord willing, encourages us to care for each other as well.
Well, and I think that's the important thing to remember, that this unity that we have is not because we're in agreement whether we should have sprinkles on our donuts or not, but mm-hmm. it is because of the love of Jesus Christ and the forgiveness of sins we have. And now of course, in the real world, you mentioned the fact that we are all united and the fact that we believe it is Jesus' body and blood there given and shed for us for the forgiveness of sins. And yet, on the other hand, there may be some Christians who don't agree with that particular thing. And so we might have to say, well, we really can't worship. We can't commune together because basically we have a different understanding of what's going on here. But you know what? I still believe that you understand and that Jesus is your Savior. You're still someone that I'm concerned about. And by gosh, if there was a need there, if there was hunger or an accident or whatever, I would want to be there to help and care for you. I think sometimes people outside of the church have trouble understanding that, but we can be divided, and yet at the same time, we can still love and care for one another, all again because of the love and forgiveness that we have in Jesus Christ.
Yeah, and I think that's a good place to wrap up, John, is that, you know, each of us, we want to, we strive to, I hope it's our prayer that we care, know and care for one another. And the whole reason is exactly like you mentioned, because our good shepherd first knew and cared for us, right? That's the motivation. That's why we do it.
So thank you very much, Matt. We will continue with another image, Christ is the Vine. This is Wrestling with the Vine.
Showing support for KFUO is now easier than ever. You can sport a KFUO shirt, swag, or even socks by visiting our online store. Go to KFUO.org/store and order high-quality KFUO-branded merch. You no longer need to wait for our annual share-a-thon for a chance to show your KFUO spirit. Visually share and wear this ministry out in the world by checking out our selection. Every purchase helps to support our proclamation of Christ for you, anytime, anywhere. Go to KFUO.org/store.